Bon dia. Our guest on episode 29 is an architect by trade, a designer and photographer at heart. She's a dreamer, a businesswoman, and trendsetter who, in her own words, is discovering how to adult. Please welcome to Kubhula, the delightful Iria Marina.
Eu não roubei a coisa de ninguém, desculpa lá muito.
Há muito boato, há muita poeira nisto tudo, mas muita poeira.
Oh, meu irmão, me deixe em paz, por favor.
O telemóvel é meu, as megas são minhas, não me provoca.
Rabo grande, mas de mente pequeno. Mama grande, mas de mente pequeno. Boca grande, mas de mente pequeno.
Também as minhas fraldas de governo e tudo, a minha cama, a minha comida, a minha prados e tudo se rasgou. Era noite.
Diziam, rasgaram porque falavam chupa sangue.
Chupa sangue. Ele está a dizer que você tem chupa sangue.
Buenas noches.
Já há muito tempo que não gravamos, já tarde.
That's true.
What time do you normally?
We either record like in the evenings, right? In the evenings. Most of them have been evenings because of people's schedules.
Ou é 8:80. Ou é à noite, ou é...
Yeah, morning.
Morning.
Yeah.
Tipo, 9
da manhã. Morning is my shit though, you know? That's like my level of energy.
I didn't know. We could have... You know, but for me, it doesn't matter because like in the mornings, it's coffee and... In the afternoons, it's alcohol, and the evenings as well. So, you know, it's... It works out.
Why you left South Africa.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like you have a problem, my friend.
No. Hey, there's balance to this life, you know? You got to balance it.
Try
have too much
vegan.
Of everything. You got to have bits and pieces, enjoy yourself, enjoy your life, you know?
But, já, sabes que é genético isso? Do que, por exemplo, tu és a morning person, como estás a dizer, que they normally call it... Morning lard. Yeah, morning lard. Depois tens o night owls. São as pessoas que normalmente são as da noite.
Yeah.
And people têm a tendência de pensar que isto é opcional, mas não é. Porque tu tens something that it's called a chronotype.
Yeah.
Yeah, chronotype, que é a manifestação do teu circadian rhythm. Não é? Quando tu... O teu awake, sleep-awake cycle.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. E isso é diferente de pessoas para pessoas, ok? 40% das pessoas são morning lards, 30% das pessoas são night owls e depois os outros 30% são in between. Portanto, tu tens pessoas que de manhã têm muito mais energia, conseguem estar mais focused,
uh-huh.
E tens pessoas que é o inverso, que trabalham melhor à noite. Por exemplo, tens muitos, for some reason, designers trabalham melhor à noite.
Yeah.
Não é? Uh-huh. São mais criativos à noite, essas coisas todas, mas tem isso tem a ver com o teu circadian rhythm.
Yeah, it's the same with musicians as well. Like producers, friends of mine that live like vampires, basically, you know, during the day.
Yeah.
They'll be sleeping in the morning because they've been up the whole night, but actually working the whole night, not, you know, playing video games and stuff.
Porque tem mesmo a ver com a tua produção de hormonas, o teu core temperature, a tua... Como tu estás mais alerta, tem esses componentes todos.
Yeah. I don't know if this is a thing, but I remember that there was someone that was telling me that they feel that working at night or at hours like after 10, they're more creative. But the reason that he mentioned why was because there's less people that are awake and actually making things that are actually functioning at that moment. Like most people are sleeping. So it feels like he's got like the universe to himself.
Yeah.
I don't know, you know, if that's a thing or something like that, but like his explanation was that there's not a lot of people, there's not a lot of people functioning. There's not a lot of people, like also not a lot of people bothering him as well. So he's able to like switch off.
It's also quieter and you do feel the universe being quieter. I suffer from insomnia, but I don't know if it's actually insomnia because I can sleep at 6 p.m. and wake up at midnight. And then from midnight, it's a go until 9, 10 a.m., you know what I mean? But at that time, it's quieter and you feel it. Like the world is just a little more still. You can think about things. And I think when I go to bed, that's my time of processing, you know? And then you open your eyes and you're just like, I've invented something.
Yeah.
But obviously, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And how, and like, how is your, because you're a creative, you do a lot. You do a lot.
Just to fill me in, porque eu não faço a mínima ideia.
You guys are meeting for the first time. Yes. I think that's what's brilliant about this podcast platform.
What do I do? I studied architecture, so by training, I studied architecture. I studied photography and documentary filmmaking. Different times, so architecture was in Durban, photography was in Cape Town, documentary filmmaking was in New York. And I am now, what I do is I do fashion. Like, I'm a fashion designer. That's what I do from 9 to 5 every day. Oh, is there even a 9 to 5? But also include all of those little things. So that's pretty much a little bit of the story. And at some point I was a natural hair queen, or, you know, I started this brand of natural hair, but you kind of have to pick your battles. You can't do everything.
Yeah.
It's just impossible to do everything well. So you
jack of all trades.
Yeah,
master
yeah.
Master of none.
Master of none, exactly. Yeah. So you even photography, it's something that I'm a natural at, and I'm really,
you are.
I feel like I'm really good at it. It's just a natural talent. I had to choose where, if I was going to continue being a photographer full time, or if I was going to go into something that gives me more stability. And I guess that's the thing about growing up. You have to be a realist. You have bills to pay. And my friends, 90% are not artists. So they live in the good life, going to Zambie, Chapo. Your broke ass can only afford to go to Takdir. Oh, hell no.
Yeah.
It's but, the reality.
But like, you said something there that I think, so we had Iliana Nzualu on this platform as well. And what's amazing is that, like, she was saying that she is, you know, she's an author, an artist, like, full time. She doesn't have, like, you know, a day job, or, you know, no disrespect to, like, day jobs. I've got one. But, like, she was talking about it in a way that, like, that's the only thing that she does. And also that I find that very special in the Mozambican context, because not a lot of people have that opportunity to do that. You know, it's either you have your day job and then you have your you know, either side hustle or hobby or creative, you know, project, whatever you want to call it. But you mentioned there that, you know, you got to pay bills and all of that. Like, for you, you're doing fashion full time.
Yeah. So for me, people look at me and they're like, "Yo, you're so lucky to be doing fashion." But for me, fashion, as much as I love it, it's actually the job to pay the bills.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean?
Okay.
Like, if you are a banker or an economist, that is my job.
Okay.
And that's a job that I pay taxes in. I have employees, so I have to pay 3-4 salaries. I have to rent out a place. I have to spend money to make money, you know? So people see it as, oh, you're creative, it's a gift. Nah, the same way you have to pay bills, you know, I have to, probably even more, because once you have your own company, you know how it is. When you have your own company, you have people that you have to take care of. And it's hard. It's hard to have that responsibility.
You're feeding families.
Onto you. Yeah. I mean, there's been times where I'm like, man, I'm tired. Not because I'm not making money, but just because psychologically it F's with your mind. I don't know if I can swear in this platform.
You can swear in any language you'd like.
Yeah, it really bothers you. You're just like, man, I don't even have a family of my own, but I'm responsible for making sure that my employees have a salary every month. It weighs on you hectically. Yeah. So there's yin and yangs to all of this. So fashion is, there's the creative side to it, but once you turn it into a business, it's a business.
Eu tenho só para fazer um comentário acerca disto, eu tenho conhecidos que são criativos, são pessoas que trabalham para outras pessoas são, e que gostam de criar. E uma das conversas que eu estava a ter com um deles, e ele estava-me a explicar que quando eu deixar de ser criativo e for um business owner, eu vou deixar de fazer aquilo que eu gosto. Não é? Porque tu tens de deixar de ser o criativo e tens de começar a pensar dessa maneira que estás a dizer, não é? Que tens que pagar salários, tens de te preocupar com A, B e C, problemas administrativos. E isso tudo, quando começas a fazer por isso, estás a fazer for the money, mas não é o que tu estás a fazer for the passion, porque o que tu gostas de fazer não é gerir uma empresa, o que tu gostas de fazer é criar. E quando tu passas esse step, deixas de ser o criativo empregado, quote unquote, e passas a ser o criativo chefe, ou boss, ou leader, whatever adjetivo tu queres usar, vais deixar de ter aquela paixão pelo que tu estás a fazer.
Yeah, because you also then, you're told that you have to study your market. You know, you learn all these things, like study your market, study what your market needs. I don't give a shit what the market needs. I want to do my shit, you know? The reason I started this thing was because I wanted to do my shit, not because I wanted to study the market. So it's been a lot of frustration there, but there's also a beauty in it. In everything in life, it's like when you deal with a client, right? A client comes to you because they see your clothes and they're like, okay, I feel that. So they come to you and they're like, okay, I like this, but I want it like this. So the you have to find a middle ground. So satisfy the client. So that item, would you wear it? Would it be part of your brand, right? At the same time, this is your client's vision also. So together you marry the two, you know? So there is a way where you can turn it not just for it to be business, but there's times where it's a little bit hard. But you got to be strong. You got to actually take breaks. I mean, that's the thing about not traveling now. I used to travel so much, not only to go and buy fabrics and Joburg, whatever, but to actually just get out of my office, go think about what to do creatively, see my friends, you know, have great food, visit great places, get inspired so that I can come back with all this like vavoom to create more things. But man, oh man, you know the times we live in now, you got to sit in your backyard and find creativity now.
No, but also like there's a lot of places even around us, yeah, that, you know, some are a bit further away, but there's a lot of places that you can go to and kind of like hide out, if you use those kind of terms. But I'm at least hoping that this time, especially local tourism, that, you know, us locals, we can explore a bit more of, you know, what we have here in Moz. You know, I don't know how things are going to develop now with, you know, are more flights going to be available. Maybe Mr. Pilot can give us some insights about that. But
we need to be going. We want to go to Iria, man. Hook us up.
And there's obviously high tensions in that area of the country as well. So there's a lot of there's a lot of shit going on, you know. But I think something I wanted to mention that Marcy spoke of about like friends of his that are creatives, and then if they become like business owners, being a creative, then becoming a business owner, putting on these different hats and all of that. Like something that I think that maybe it will come more in our generation and the next generation, but I think that there should be more and more opportunities for people to work together. So what I mean by people working together, it's that people have various skills and people are good at something better than they are at other things. So it's more about as entrepreneurs, as people that are passionate in the skills that they have, of coming together and working together towards a common goal.
Yeah.
So whether one example is you're a fashion designer, you're also a photographer, you have many skills and all of that. The fashion, as you mentioned, is what is currently paying your bills and all of that. And maybe you see that, all right, flip, you know, my financial management is not great, you know, but, you know, there's this guy or this person that is good at financial management, and that person's also passionate about fashion as well. And then it's a thing of where, you know, can we work together in some sort of way to grow our
Speaking about that.
I know it's all roses the way I explain it.
No. Like, it actually isn't. Let me tell you why. Like, I've been doing that a lot as of late, right?
Ah, okay.
So things can be quite hard. And as of late, I've been needing a bit more therapy, etc., you know? So there was a point where I was like, man, therapy is expensive, you know? How do I pay for this? Because I got bills to pay, you know? and my therapist was like, you know, I really like your stuff. If you can't pay, it's fine. Just create some stuff for me and that'll be payment. And it's funny because I've actually been doing that. My graphic designer, we do that. I mean, there's a limit. So I do stuff for her, but I also want to make sure that I physically also pay her, even if it's not 100%
of what a percentage, she's used to getting,
but also then we trade with my services. But not only that, you know, Corona's brought out beautiful things. People are so gutful. People are so kind. People are so generous. I'm currently, I have about, I think, 4 collaborations two of them have been on the show.
I had to.
I won't mention too much because, you know, you got to have that like, pa-ping, you know, that X factor. When is this episode coming out?
Next week.
Ha, perfect.
Well, okay. The listeners won't know when that is, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But next week. So by the time you hear this, I think the collab that I did with Regina and with Edward, Edward was the art director, I was the photographer and obviously the fashion designer, and Regina was the model, and we in collaboration with Museo de Mafalala. So we did he's amazing. He gave us the most amazing tour. The museum was so closed because we wanted to scout for the place, the timing, all of that.
Yeah.
It was incredible. That place is fantastic. Fantastic. Yeah, so that collab. Oh, and Dabanga.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know her.
I do.
Yeah, so yeah,
my colleague works a lot with her, yeah.
That's 5 people? Yeah, so that was a collaboration with 5 different creatives that we put together. So you should see the photos next week of what we've done. That's one.
Amazing.
Yeah, that's one collab. The other one that is coming up, I'm sure I can speak about it, is with Fifi Filipa Monjane. She was here. We're creating something beautiful with her that goes with her essence, but also with my essence. So that's also something. Corona's beautiful times, I'm telling you.
Amazing to hear. Yeah. That's amazing to hear because during, you know, if there was no Rona, I guess we would have all been in our, you know, rat race, sort of doing things the way we've always known them. Make money, and then, you know, and now it's sort of helped all of us to like sort of like slow down.
And think about what's important, man.
Yeah.
And think about what's important. I mean, I heard from on the Wasi episode where she was talking about fabrics, and you also mentioned something about, you know, using how designers have to be more conscious of what fabric and where the fabric is also coming from, you know. So all of that we've taken into consideration, and people are starting to appreciate that there is a process. There is appreciation for fabric, for rawness, for, I guess it's also a time where we have to be healthier.
Yeah.
So that comes into mind quite a lot. Health in terms of what you wear, what goes into your body, everything. Yeah,
sort of body cream you use to, you know, whatever. Like more and more the consumer is becoming more conscious of what's, you know, it's no longer like the finished product. They want to know all the way from like the raw materials being used.
Yeah.
A história toda por trás, não é?
Yeah.
Mas isso é o que encanta também e que faz com que as pessoas adiram a marca, não é?
Yeah.
E queiram fazer parte porque they can somehow gravitate towards their story, to what they represent e essas coisas todas, não é? Mm-hmm. Não é só uma bolsa ou uma t-shirt ou uma capulana ou whatever it is.
Yeah, and that's exactly how we actually started doing our origami masks. I thought about Filomena, I don't know if you know her. She's brilliant.
Noted.
Yeah. So she hollered at me and she said, are you doing any masks that are with raw fabric, no dyes, or dyed natural dyes with teas, etc., you know, or linens? And I said to her, no, I'm actually not. And she's like, I would like some because I don't want any ink, etc., in my body, especially my face, acne, all of that. So I thought about it. That's how these masks came about. So the first ones were done with raw fabric. Yeah. So we have a range of them, which are linen. So it's representing more of the raw product. And it's been really special to us because I also wanted a mask that was really good in terms of wearable and how you use them. You'll get yours next week. This is what I forgot, actually. Oh. The gifts that I wanted to give you. Yes.
Oh, we got
gifts. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And just on that, while people are listening about the masks, where can people get them? Like, what
is it? Iria Marina Designs. Yeah. All the info is there.
All right.
We also have our studio. Yeah, we have our studio here in Somerset, but we like to get calls first. We don't really like a lot of people coming in just to prevent the whole situation right now. And you can also get them at the Fab Lab. Sia is selling them also at the Fab Lab. If you're in Johannesburg, you can also get them.
What?
I have someone selling them there. Yes, Tony Miyambo. Yeah. Yes. And nice. There'll be a few more places. I'm having meetings with a few more places around Maputo that really want to sell them. So, yeah.
Explica lá um bocadinho como é que funciona o processo. Fiquei curioso.
Oh, the Origa mask?
Yeah.
So, the Origa mask, what's brilliant about them is, apart from them being really dope, like in terms of design, they cup well. So, you know, you can talk. You can talk well without, you know, them touching. Yeah, so they're still made with three layers and these are made with the raw fabric. So we also have them in linen. So they're really dope. They are our most popular masks, also the most expensive one, but the most popular ones.
That's good.
Yeah, and I mean, they're here to stay. They're really good. It's a really good design. I did not invent the design. It was one of those things where, I don't know if you know, like, so how I started doing the masks.
Please tell us. Please school the listeners.
Yeah, I think it was beginning of March when there was the whole Corona saga. Corona wasn't even here in Mozambique yet. And I had a flu because I'm very flu-y. So I thought to myself, okay, I don't want to get anybody. People were sensitive to sneezing, et cetera, you know. So I thought to myself, I'm so sorry, that's me.
Tell them that you're on a podcast.
It's my other phone that I always forget
so
about.
So whoever's not familiar with the way things are here in Moz, it's like we have two cell phones for like, you know, the different mobile providers, you know. So you'll have like an 8-something and an 8-something and you have two, three phones.
And you completely forget about them.
That's true.
Yeah, that's me on
one
that
rings
phone.
And then like, I tried you on that one and I'm calling you on this one.
That's how it is. Anyways,
it's all good,
yeah. So the sneezing, etc. So I decided, okay, let me make myself a mask so that I protect people against my sneezes, you know? Yeah, and I made one. I posted on Instagram and everybody was like, what? Whoa, we need those masks. We need those masks. So that's how it started. So I started by playing around with what I needed, my own necessity. And then I told my workers, okay, you guys need to make some. And it was weird because in the beginning, I got a lot of backlash. You shouldn't be doing masks. It's not actually good for you, etc. So it was like a yin and yang, you know? So some people, yay, some people, no. And it took us a while. And then I remember going to talk to a lady who worked in Mizao. And she said to me, actually, you should continue doing the mask because in a few weeks we're going to announce that every Mozambican has to wear masks. So you're on the right track. So she just said, okay, make sure that there's a pocket if you're going to make it two layers or make it three layers. And at that time, every mask I was doing had a pocket. Guys, I learned it from the Chinese, literally. I'm like, what are they doing there when the masks finish? What are they doing? That's how it actually works.
Inside trade information. That should be, that must be illegal.
Yo, that's the evolution.
She said the lady used to.
But guys, you know what's so funny? At that time in March, you'd go to YouTube to search for masks. No one had a YouTube. Only the Chinese. So that's how I learned it. And the masks were
crap. Now you go in there, you'll find them in every language.
Guys, now it's just like... It's like underwear now. That's what I say.
Yeah, it's the way of life. But that's amazing. So it's interesting. There was pros and cons. So like, you know, you have people that will be like, yeah, okay, like masks, great thing. It's coming up. You know, you're ahead of the trend. Mm. You know, is that the word? Yeah, ahead of the trend and all of that. And then you have people that are, you know, against it and saying that, you know, you can't breathe in them, you like, you know, that sort of thing. But yeah, you know, it's you're never going to be able to satisfy everybody,
fashion.
And who knows, life. You could have been making masks because, you know, people are up to some kinky shit and they like wearing masks in the bedroom. Who knows, right? Don't judge people. That's what I'm saying.
That's right. Yeah,
ninguém gosta de usar essas porcarias na cara.
Yeah.
Right? It's not normal, mas... Se tu vais entrar num sítio onde é preciso usar, usa. Like, remember, back in the days, também tinha até agora, né? Back in the days, tipo, no shirt, no service. Não é? Nas praias tinhas isso. Tu também, sempre que foste ao club, há clubes que tu sabias que tinhas que grifar um bocadinho mais. Senão não
deviam... Or certain button shirts, shoes.
Yeah. As a man, senão you can't wear sneakers. Yeah. Yeah.
Porque senão não tinham deixar entrar.
Yeah.
Porque sempre existiu esses requirements. Yeah. Agora... É só mais um agora, é só a máscara. Então, usas a máscara também. Eu não sei porque que as pessoas são tão self... I don't even know how to explain it. Porque
são
tão against it, né?
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, people will always be against something, man. Like, that's the conclusion I've always come to. Is like, people will always complain about something. And then they'll just get used to it. Then it will just, like, go away. And then the next thing will come up.
Yeah, but I think in Africa we're doing good. We're being quite diligent about it. I mean, because if you see what's happening overseas, I mean, people are protesting to not wear masks. Yeah. So that's insane.
But that's also a good sign. É um sinal que lá a democracia deles funciona, que lá the voice of the people is heard, que lá eles podem fazer isto. Experimenta lá tu aqui fazer uma manifestação.
Yeah. Yeah. Forget you.
Now shut you down quick.
Shut it down.
Os únicos que conseguem fazer manifestação são os Germans. Eu não vejo mais ninguém a conseguir fazer manifestações como deve
ser. Like peaceful ones, right? Like proper.
Tipo, proper, que eles tinham um horário, tinham os dias da semana.
Guys, I think Germans tinham não tem. Like, Germans have been doing that, I think, for over 20 years. The same. I mean, I really feel sorry for them. You know, it's time like the country gives them a little bit. A little bit.
Eu, sabes que eu nem sei exatamente qual é o que é que eles estão a manifestar. Acho que são que eles foram trabalhar fora e depois os salários haviam um acordo entre os governos.
And they haven't been.
Havia um acordo dos governos e o governo de lá entregou o dinheiro ao governo de cá ou something like that and then it vanished. E eles não receberam. Isso é a ideia que eu tenho que é o que eles estão a reivindicar.
African magic.
What money? What money?
mas também se fazes muitas manifestações, as pessoas começam a ficar numb to it, não é? As pessoas começam a... Quando é que foi a última vez que tu ouviste falar dos Germans? Antes disto que nós estamos a falar agora.
Yeah, I mean, I heard about it because I saw them marching, you know, a few months ago. But you're right.
That's about it, não é?
It's because I was there. And that's it. No one talks about it, you know?
Sim, é só tipo, ah, os Magermas estão de novo. Ah, não vais pelo Eduardo Mondlane porque o trânsito está mal porque estão lá os Magermas. Ah, ok.
Hoje é dia dos Magermas. Yeah.
It's bad, it's really bad.
Epa.
But, yeah, So now you were mentioning about, like, the fashion is paying your bills and all of that. You were involved in Green is the New Black, which was last year.
Yeah.
So can you tell us a bit about, like, Green is the New Black for whoever doesn't know about it? I know that it was a British High Commission, and the British High Commissioner endorsed this project. to find designers from young designers from Mozambique. I know that Wasi and Jamila from Karingana were also involved in helping to organize.
Yeah, so they were the coordinators of the whole project. So they took care of everything. So they were hired to organize everything about the project. But Green is the New Black was a sustainable competition. So it wasn't about finding the designs. It was about showing that we, as Africans, also Mozambicans, we can do sustainable fashion. So now, in the beginning, when I was approached, At some point I was, but before it was, I thought about, do I want to be a mentor or a mentee? Because I'm at the standard where I can be a mentor. But then I like to learn, guys. And I'm just so tired of being the person to show something, you know, because I'm already a boss.
Learning, yeah.
You know, so I want to learn something. I want to learn something more. And sustainability was actually, that's how I started fashion. 3 years ago, I started by doing upcycling of jackets. So you'd bring your leather jacket or whatever, and then I would put capulana on it and make it look pretty, etc. Or use jeans, which I still do until now. Used proper jeans, rip them apart, you know, and then create new pieces. So I've always been doing upcycling. This as, again, as a business. But for personal use, I've been doing it since I was a little girl. It's like, oh, you like that piece of yours, tarashgadu, you know, you change it up, you know? So I wanted to learn more. I wanted to learn what other possibilities are there. So I entered as a contestant. I won third place. It was a beautiful time. It was 1 month of a lot of stress, a lot of hard work to create these outfits.
You guys are supposed to go to London.
Yes.
But then Rona, right?
Do you know what it is for your visa to come out and you have to pack up like you're going to London? I think it was 3 or 5 days later. And then I think like 3 days before your trip, it's canceled. And we were so excited. There was this whole beautiful schedule. We're going to go to a few cities, meet a few designers, etc. But the Rona, man, the Rona had other plans.
Yeah, I know. I've been following quite a bit of the story and all of that. And I remember them talking about like that you guys are going to go in March. And then March hit and I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, we have visas. We have visas.
Yeah. But it's suspended, so maybe like next year, depending on what happens.
We'll see what happens. What they've done now, we're trying to do everything online. Okay. It's really hard because Mozambicans, we're not all very technically savvy and like that.
The connections can be a bit funny.
Yeah, and then
the certeza que não é a mesma coisa.
Yeah.
No, nowhere.
Nothing beats face to face.
And also right now we're going through a lot. Some of us are depressed. Some of us are jobless. Some of us are job filled. You know, it's not the same. So it's really hard to coordinate. And to be honest, I'm sick and tired of Zoom meetings.
Yeah, I get fatigued. I get fatigued by Zoom meetings because always the first few seconds, it's always like, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Sorry, your mic is off. Like, you're on mute.
Even WhatsApp videoing, I think now I do it less just because I'm just tired of all these video things, you know? I just feel like, you know, every single time you gotta be ready for a Zoom meeting. It's prayer, it's work, it's friends, it's family.
It is tiring, like especially and nothing beats face to face, but then like face to face is obviously what we can't really do.
Yeah, it's the problem.
Yeah.
guys.
But like, I just kind of feel that like once this massive wave, we don't know if there's going to be a second wave or third wave or whatever it is, but like when there's some sort of like people are back to schools are open and like there's some sort of normality, I don't know what to call it anymore. I have a feeling that like people are going to go ham. People are going to go like hard as a motherfucker. Like, like, yeah, there's going to be extremes. There's going to be...
Guys, the simple thing is just like hugging your friend.
Yeah. But there's going to be excess, man. Like, it's coming. Like, because people are building up a lot of things, you know? Like, building up, like, inside, yeah, emotionally.
Estamos a ferver.
E mesmo, let's say, 2021 fica tudo bem, né? Dia 31 de dezembro, pá, acabou tudo. Dia 1 de janeiro, 2021, yeah, já está tudo bem, né?
Dia 31 acaba tudo, né? Yeah,
dia 1 de janeiro, já está tudo bem. Tudo que as pessoas não fizeram profissionalmente, yeah, emotionally, férias, tudo que não fizeram vai ser tudo packed dentro de 2021. Então, eu acho que 2021 possivelmente vai ser
o melhor ano
de todos os tempos.
Unless the aliens
come. We're going to be grateful. We're waiting for them too.
We're waiting for them this year. We're waiting for them aliens this year. Yeah, it's going to be a party.
We're looking for any foreigners, yeah, whether it's aliens or not. We don't care.
And maybe, just maybe, think about it though. Maybe it's the aliens that have the cure for Corona.
Oh man, that's a good one.
Maybe.
That's my favorite, X Files. Just maybe we await.
Yeah. And how is it being a businesswoman in Mozambique? Like, for anyone that's listening to this, that is, I know, you know, wanting to be an entrepreneur, you know, someone's listening to this and going, I hate my job, or I got fired, or I got let off, and I'm wanting to, like, I also like fashion, or also like, you know, photography, and I want to pursue it. I want to, like, really get serious of it, because this Rona thing has really opened my eyes and I got to chase my dreams. What's your experience been like as someone that feeds families and pays taxes? What has that experience been like, and the challenges for you?
Man, being a business owner in itself anywhere, because I think I started in South Africa first, you know? And in South Africa, it felt like everyone was doing it, you know? You didn't feel special. Coming to Mozambique, there's something about Mozambique that makes you feel super creative. Like, the possibilities are endless. You may not make money, but the possibility are endless. And that's what this place has been for me, because I lived out for so long, I think about 20 years, coming back, you know, I went into my mother's house. I didn't have to pay any bill for the first time in such a long time. So I could concentrate on just creating and being creative. I mean, now I do. Now I live on my own, all of that. But, you know, back then, so I could just create. And I don't know, I have to speak, I speak differently because I didn't grow up here. So it was easier to have a following and a backing from my people in terms of you are one, you know, you also grew up outside of Mozambique, etc., you know? So it came, you almost come with an army, you know? Yeah. I actually call it, and it's not in any bad way, but I actually call this group International Mozambicans, because you're a little bit more open to giving chance and seeing the value of things. Because in Mozambique, example, if I create a jacket, right, and I tell someone the jacket is 5,000, they're going to be like, what? I can just go to Mercado and get this thing done for 700, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You don't understand that there's a design concept behind it. You don't actually understand that there is salaries to pay, studios to rent. The fact that you're seeing me and I am going through the process with you, and then I have people sewing this. So it's a whole team. But yet for you, you rather say, this is not worth 5,000. It's worth 700. So it's in those terms. So what I chose to do is look at who my público alvo is, you know, who are they? And to be honest, it's foreigners and international Mozambicans, people that understand and value the work. Not to say that Mozambicans aren't. There are a few that, like, grew up here that understand. But a lot of clients, what I tend to do is I tend to school clients. So if a client comes to me and says, what? That's a lot. So you just charm them because you mustn't, it's a client. Don't push them away.
Yeah.
So, you know, my favorite is, but how much are you worth? You know, I mean, for a person like you, it can't be too little, you know?
But tu achas que isso é cultural ou achas que tem mais a ver com o poder de compra das pessoas?
É o poder de compra. É o poder de compra e também é cultural, porque nós crescemos indo ao costureiro. Quando eu cheguei, eu ia para os mercados, eu ia para aquele senhor na rua que fazia algo por 700, não sei o quê, criar minhas peças que eu queria para mim. Só que eu comecei a ver que the finishing isn't right. They tell me, okay, come tomorrow, you go tomorrow, they tell you come back the next day. And then when you actually come back and they're almost done with your stuff, you've got to sit there for 5 hours with them and sew with them, you know? And nothing is done right. You end up leaving angry, but you've paid them. And then I thought to myself, do I really want this kind of life? Why can't people be honest? Why can't people be honest and say, I can't do this right now, come back and just have a... follow through, you know, follow through. Get a tabela, write it down, you know, this client and that client. Nada, nós. It's very, very difficult to work with people here. Even my own tailors, my own team. It's the third year and I'm still teaching them, please be honest, even when you are late. Boss, I'm going to be 20 minutes late because maybe it's a shopper or because I passed through there. Why do you have to keep quiet or come back and come give me other excuses? I just don't get it.
Histórias.
So those little things have been a challenge, but creatively, it's the best space because it's funny because I sell a lot more internationally being here than I did when I was away. I guess it's more exotic, like, oh, that comes from Mozambique and is coming to South Africa. But it's like, but I was in South Africa for 20 years and you people didn't appreciate me. I guess at that point I'm considered South African, eh? Like, you're one of us.
Yeah.
You know?
It's
também é normal as pessoas quererem comprar sempre o que é de fora, não é? O que é de fora é sempre melhor do que é nosso. Essa é a mentalidade normal de todo mundo,
todo
não é?
Mundo,
tu estás na Europa, queres coisas africanas, estás em África, queres coisas da Europa, estás nos Estados Unidos, queres something from South America, é isso, tu nunca estás satisfeito com aquilo que tens ali, porque o que tu comprares locally, todo mundo tem acesso.
Yeah.
And you want to stand out.
Yeah.
You want to be... And you can't get access to things that not everyone has,
for some. Yeah, I mean, I have friends that they like wearing everything custom made.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's either custom made or limited
edition.
Friends in
high places, I see, my friend.
It's, you know,
and for me, that's
like, wow, like I'm the type of person that, like, even if it's a plain white T-shirt and, you know, I'm comfortable in it and I look good in it, then I'll wear it. You know, it's not a thing of like, oh, no, but no, that has to be, you know, it has to be off-white. It has to be Supreme. It has to be like all these, you know, Gucci, Louis Vuitton. It has to be all these like different brands or luxury brands or whatever it is. But, you know, but at the end of the day, you know, it's funny. Speaking of clothing, I've realized that like the more clothes I have, the longer I take to get ready. So meaning that like now that we you know, right now during, you know, the Rona tales.
Yeah.
The Rona times.
Yeah.
You know, that could almost be like a newsletter, the Rona times.
Uh-huh, the Rona times.
It for me, like I don't have much clothes here in Moz. You know, I do have clothes that, you know, when I would do the back and forth sort of thing.
Yeah.
But now I'm wearing a lot of these clothes, like a lot.
Yeah.
Right? But then I realized that like I actually get dressed quicker than, you know, where in South Africa I have like a lot more clothes that I don't have right now. And my choices of what to wear are more and I take longer to get ready. But now I can get ready, you know, in short amount of time because I have less choices. So my question is, do you find that as well? Like, for example, there's people that have like 5 white tees and that's what they're going to wear that week. And because, you know, it's just their thought of And apparently there's a lot of people that think like this, that the less choices you have in the morning in terms of like what to wear. So that's why he has like 5 white tees or like 5 black tees. And that's what he's going to wear that week. And just plain blue jeans and, you know, sneakers you can always like change up or whatever, whatever, because it's less choices to make in the morning. I don't know if you've ever thought about things that way or ever had that.
Well, I think I'm going through that now. But that's just because probably I've gained, like, it's the corona gaining weight factor, for real. Like, most of your clothes don't fit.
Yeah, I wish I could say I'm gaining weight, but, you know, I eat so much and I stay like this. So.
Oh,
yeah, you're
show off.
Problema.
Yeah, we, but we both have fast metabolism. Yeah,
why y'all showing off like this, man?
Good genes.
I'm calling my therapist after this.
I was bullied.
But we're talking about it the other day that, like, it's also like if you're skinny, you know, in African culture, you can be like, hey, Hugo, are you okay?
Not like, Mozambican, you know, African like, culture. They're like, oh, you're good. Stay like this. But don't get skinnier than this.
Yeah, if you get skinny, you know, like, it'll be like, are you okay? Is everything okay?
It's all me now.
Yeah, I don't know, man. You guys are lucky. But anyways, I feel that now it's a lot of factors. It's the fact that, you know, I'm not feeling my sexiest, etc. So I get dressed to get out. You know what I mean? But there's something, like, I was thinking about it the other day. I was like, damn, girl, you need to lose that weight because you need to bring sexy back. And not for anybody, but for yourself, you know? There'd be days where I'd be dressing up at home and looking at myself in the mirror and like, you're looking sexy. Okay, done now for an hour. Take it off. Get back into your pajamas. There's something. I mean, don't you feel like when you wear something that's not your norm, you feel some other type of way, you know?
Mas tu agora tocando nesse assunto, you design clothes, you sell them.
Mm-hmm.
Agora como as pessoas não estão a sair tanto, não se vestem como tu estás a dizer, you don't dress to impress no more. Mm. Porque ficam mais tempo em casa, o teu revenue...
Better get my good side.
O revenue de show?
Subiu. So, let me tell you, when I say to you that for me, corona has been a gift, it really has. So I've never stopped working. You know how people shut down? I went from doing the masks to doing hundreds and thousands of masks and changing them up to then coming up with clothes because I think I always think about Mozambican problems, Mozambican solutions for Mozambican problems, you know? And I am a Mozambican problem. So what is my solution? So I started thinking about that. That's one of the reasons why I started making kimonos, because kimonos are comfortable. You just want to chill. You want to enjoy yourself, but you want to look bright and fashionable, you know? So everything has increased. Like I need more tailors, but I can't because everything is so expensive to bring into the country. Like machines are unbelievable. You know what I mean? So I've never actually stopped working, and people can't go out and buy stuff, so they have to come and make stuff, you know?
Okay.
So
yes.
It's such a win. But because life is calmer, what I've started doing is you don't come to me and you say, oh, I saw this t-shirt, you know? I want you to make it to exactly like this. I'm very clear to my clients is, you want a t-shirt? Come. But I'm going to redesign it because this has to be an Iria Marina Designs product, and I'm not trying to steal anyone's design. You know what I mean? So it's been a gift because I think there's that process also of customizing, even if it's just a little bit. Maybe the gala changes, but there's change, you know?
Yeah.
And having fun, doing collabs with fabric shops, doing collabs with, you know, it's really... I cannot complain about this period. I think it's teaching me a lot, and it's teaching us that where there's a will, there's a way. So don't shut down. Just find another way. Find another way. Yeah.
Os teus kimonos são Japanese inspired or existem kimonos africanos?
Well, I don't think that we really have African kimonos like that. We're more of batik tunicas as Africans, you know. One where, so I do the tunicas. So I love Japanese culture and all. I just love, I mean, this mask is Japanese inspired. I love the structure. I mean, I did study architecture, you know, so structure, kimonos. So my whole idea with the kimonos was I wanted something that was Japanese inspired, but turn it African, you know, so that brings style. Like, não é só usar só coisas por usar. Let's bring some style.
Bad mouth in the Japanese.
No offense to you.
Hey, but you know, everyone has their choices. Everyone has their preferences. And there's nothing wrong with that.
And there's nothing wrong with also being simple. I mean, there's nothing more cleaner and simple than beautiful, actually, than seeing a man in like blue jeans and a white tee.
Yeah, blue jeans, white tee.
And maybe like an Iria Marina design jacket on top of that. You know what I mean?
Plug it, girl. Plug it.
Sasha. É por isso que eu nunca percebi muito bem quando as pessoas falam de cultural appropriation.
Yeah.
Nunca percebi muito bem e nunca fui muito... I never joined that bandwagon. Porque para mim, that's the beauty of it. É tipo, se tu gostas de uma coisa de outra cultura qualquer, não é? Se tu gostas de uma cultura qualquer, tu vais e fazes and you give it your own little twist.
Oh, yeah.
E de certa maneira tu tá, é uma como é que eu posso dizer the word is missing now, mas é de maneira que tu mostras aos outros.
But it's an appreciation for another,
exatamente,
yeah,
exatamente,
for another
por outra
culture.
Cultura.
Yes.
E é graças a isso que nós temos e é graças a isso que nós temos vários restaurantes com várias comidas, várias coisas em Moçambique. Nem todo restaurante italiano é um italiano a fazer as suas pizzas.
Or else then we should just be eating shima e couve.
Exactly. Então, that's the beauty of it. Quanto mais tu puderes ir buscar fora, inspiraste e fazer deste global community onde todo mundo usa tudo e de todos, é que vamos ter muito mais pros than cons if you do that.
I mean, life is about experiences anyway. So let's experience the whole fucking world in one one country even. You know what I mean?
Because yeah, exactly.
Sometimes you can't go out there. So, and just tune into your own culture also if you want to. If you don't, you don't. I mean, sometimes I just want to... I've created some kimonos that are completely simple, which is just linen. You know what I mean? Very Japanese, very them, and nothing like African inspired except for like the rawness of it, you know? Yeah, and that's okay too. We don't all have to like a pulana. We don't all have to like, I mean, what is African style also? Like, if we think about Mozambique, what's our style? Like, what's our...
Não, é super complicado. Começamos a ir para trás. Tu não vais perceber, por exemplo, tu pensas em pasta, tu pensas... Né? Italy, pensas em batata, ok, vamos dizer que Ireland, chocolate, Swiss chocolate, não é? And tens essas coisas, se pensas na Argentina, vais pensar em carne, não é?
Yes,
because
yes,
they're famous for,
yes,
for their meat.
Yes, and the srirachas. And,
yeah, essas coisas todas, estás a ver? Mas nenhum desses países... se pensas, por exemplo, na Índia, vais pensar em piripiri, não é? Ou em chili stuff. Nenhuma destas coisas que eu acabei de dizer são originais desses países. None of it.
Yeah.
Chocolate não é da Suíça. Pasta não é italiano. Meat não é... Só,
I feel like
só
you've
depois
been
de,
watching Chef's Table.
Só depois de
1500...
só, depois de, só depois de 1500 e depois das conquistas é que eles conseguiram ter vacas lá and meat and beef and all of that. Não é? Tipo, Júlio César nunca comeu meatballs with pasta. Gandhi nunca... pôs piripiri na comida, não Gandhi, I'm sorry, Buda. Gandhi é mais recente, mas estou a falar de Buda. So, all of that veio de vários sítios e foi para lá, como tu estavas a dizer agora, perguntaste bem, o que é nosso cá? Porquê que nós só temos que gostar de uma coisa? Porquê que temos que nos meter numa little box e dizer que é isto que nós somos, nós vestimos isto e nós gostamos disto? Doesn't make sense.
Yeah, I get your point. I agree. Doesn't have to be just because it's from that place. If it's something you relate to, something that inspires you, something that drives you, something that makes you feel good or happy, then there's nothing wrong with taking a part of that and maybe adding your own spin to it.
É isso. I mean, but and also like you know, in the world of fashion, they say everything has been done already. You just kind of like rearrange it. I mean, that's how we even see cars now, you know, like every car is, it almost feels like every model has been done, but it's just now it's just,
yeah.
You know, you twist it a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
Such is life, man. That's the beauty of life. You can relive moments. I think that's how...
It's like fashion. Things come back, right? That's how fashion, some things come back from... Yeah.
That's how my 90s project exhibition was.
Exactly.
Yeah, it was about the return of the 90s in the 2000s.
And it's funny because a lot of the clothes that they were wearing in the photos of that exhibition that you did, are there any links online to that? I mean,
Yes, there's...
Because I thought that was really, really
there's
cool.
A few things on YouTube under my channel, Iria Marina. But if you also Google Iria Marina 90s project...
Yeah.
How did that come about?
How did that come about in terms of like the idea? Was it just you woke up one day and you were like, I missed the 90s. Let's do a 90s project. Or was it like, you know, or was it like one of those things where you like chatting with friends and then like friends like, remember when we used to do that or whatever? Yeah. How did that come about?
I think it was a mix. So I had this plan for my life when I was 29. I'm 30. How old am I now? I'm 32 now, right? So when I was 29, I came up with this whole bucket list concept where I needed to achieve like a career bucket list.
Yeah.
I actually did a talk on this for Standard Bank and for Grace and Michelle Foundation dinner, like gala. I actually presented the whole bucket list concept.
Friends in high places.
Yeah. Just saying. I mean, it was a brilliant concept because it forces you to concentrate on what you actually, that's how I discovered that I'm sticking to fashion. Because the bucket list career concept idea came with me wanting to do, if I die by 30, what would I have said that I succeeded in my life? Would I have done exhibitions? Would I have created a brand? What would I have done with my life, you know? So that's exactly how it happened. I decided that I wanted to learn how to be a makeup artist. I decided that I wanted to start photography again. I wanted to do fashion again, my hair product line. And I wanted to do, the last thing I wanted to do was do the exhibition, my first exhibition. I did not want to die in Triashbash without doing one exhibition, a solo exhibition. So the 90s came about. It was very organic. I think I was wearing a jacket or something, or my cousin or something. And my mother said, hey, we used to wear that so much in the 90s. And then she started telling me stories of the 90s. Like, man, those days in the 90s, you know, we fought so hard for liberation, etc. You know, the peace treaty was signed in. The music, etc. So then I was like, man, the 90s is coming back full blown in terms of fashion, in terms of music. But what has changed and what do we miss about the 90s? The project is also very political. Like back then, how was politics? How is it different to the Mozambique that we know now, you know, and internationally? So I decided to gather up and coming artists, etc., put them in 90s wear and represent the different zones where I also knew and some that I grew up in the 90s. You know what I mean?
Mas zonas como? Zonas em Moçambique, como Alto Maia, Maputo?
Okay. Yeah, Alto Maia. Mafalala, como é que chama aqui mesmo? Majangalene. Which other areas did we do? Núcleo d'Arte, which is also like a place. Some were not areas, some were places, but Núcleo d'Arte.
Iconic places.
Iconic places, you know, in the 90s that feel. Yeah, so that's what we did. So I got different groups. I mean, you guys have a picture of the one in Alto Maia. And Alto Maia is my, that's where I really, really grew up because my aunt lived there and that's where I spent a lot of my days in the 90s. Yeah, so that's how it came about. It was a mix of love, a mix of desperation, career desperation, but also of wanting to educate or re-educate Mozambicans about what happened in the 90s because people don't know, man. Guys, we don't read books in Mozambique.
Whoa.
No, we don't. Like public schools?
Yeah.
Let's not talk about the fancy schools. But we don't read books in Mozambique.
Yeah, I mean, it's yeah.
That's a whole other topic for another day.
No, that, yeah. hey. No, that's like a massive topic. But you know, I agree with you. I think it's like the other day I asked a question about where do we buy books, and like I think it was a question around that. That there's specific places where yes, you can buy books, but I think maybe what you mean is like a culture of reading. Is that what
it's
you mean?
It's lost.
Yeah.
Eu não gosto de concordar com essas coisas. Da mesma maneira, quando vamos falar dos moçambicanos são atrasados antes de começarmos a gravar.
Yeah.
E eu estava a dizer que I don't like
Mozambican
that.
Mozambican time.
Yeah, isso do Mozambican time, I don't like that.
Yeah, but then this...
Porque eu acho que qualquer generalização, it's wrong.
But it's, but
no,
it's,
no, no, but it's
like
not
that
a generalization.
Everywhere.
It's more of even... I'm not saying that the statistics is 100% like a god scientist of the government, but it's through even friends, you know, Mauro Brito, I don't know if you know him. He's tried to do projects where, you know, Mozambican so that we can read more. But it's also about seeing what's happening in the schools, you know? And I'm talking about if you speak to your helpers, example, or even my cousins who are in public schools, and you ask them, like, are you reading books? They're like, no, I mean, who reads books now, you know? And the same thing with my helpers. And the thing is, I got asking those questions because I started seeing the work that Mauro is doing, you know, and how he is really pushing for us Mozambicans to read. So I'm not trying to be negative about it. It's just, it's kind of I feel like it's a reality, and it's something that is a pity to lose, but maybe we could do more. But then again, we could do a lot more.
Eu só acho que depende, por exemplo. Tu estás, eu não sei se, por exemplo, eu leio livros para pleasure e para aprender coisas novas, e leio livros de assuntos que, super variados, não é? Desde psychology para anthropology, um monte de coisas diferentes, não é? Mas porque I find that entertaining, não porque estou a estudar. Eu não sei se tu estás a dizer num ponto de vista de escola, de estudar, da camada mais jovem, ou se estás a falar de entertainment.
I'm talking about entertainment, number one, because also for you to read books, it means that you were taught to read books. Or maybe it was an interest that you yourself acquired. And not to put anything bad on my parents, my dad reads a lot. He's, you know, my mom is an accountant, so she is like numbers. I don't care about books like that, you know? But the culture of reading, I also didn't get here in Mozambique. And I went to like 7 schools before I was 8, you know, because my parents moved so much. And then I went to Swaziland, and for the first time we were forced to read a book. It was part of the class literature, English, etc., yeah. You know, that you had to read, I think, one book every 2 weeks or something like that. And then you did a summary of it.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So that was the first time that I picked up a book. So I'm talking about just reading for pleasure, because you also taught that. That's where you learn most stuff. And it's something that is embedded in you, in yourself, you know? But you have to be incentivized to do something like that also.
Yeah, eu percebo o que estás a dizer. Mas também, por exemplo, o currículo moçambicano, eu não sei como é que funciona, então não sei se as pessoas têm que ler. Por exemplo, estás a dizer que o currículo da inglês, não é? Na Suásia era inglês, era obrigatório ler. By the nods, I can see that age you agree.
Yeah,
que
I
também,
mean, also
tudo
when
mais.
I was in primary school.
Yeah, foi a mesma coisa.
In
mas,
UK and even but when I came here.
Mas também temos que perceber que talvez isso seja trend mundial, não só trend de nós moçambicanos. Porque more and more now, tu tens acesso a esse tipo de informação por outros mediums. Por exemplo, já ninguém vai, tipo, é a mesma coisa. Ok, vou dar um exemplo um bocado radical. Mas dar o exemplo de, já ninguém usa enciclopédias. Well, yes, né? Now we have Google.
Uh-huh.
Estás a ver? Já ninguém usa ou vai procurar as coisas nos livros. Não, epá, temos internet, vamos procurar. Tens vídeos, como tu falaste agora, tu aprendeste a ver as máscaras on YouTube, on Chinese videos no YouTube. Já não é preciso. Então já há outros meios que as pessoas podem ir buscar informação, e os books, podem, como são, é um formato antigo, yes, denso, e tu tens que gostar do que estás a fazer. Tens que, é por isso que eu perguntei, é de entertainment ou knowledge seeking? Então acho que é mais complicado agora, principalmente nas gerações mais novas, porque já tens acesso a tanta coisa que tu vais procurar o que é mais pleasant para ti.
Yeah, and I totally agree with you. There's, I mean, guys, even as an adult, you know, I myself had stopped reading for a while, but then I got back into it, not only because Corona times, but also like influenced by friends, etc., etc., etc. Yeah, I mean, it's not to say that it's only the government's fault, etc. I'm not even putting fault in that, even, you know. It's just life. Life. A vida.
Life happens.
Hey. I'm shade the coisas para nos entertain, man. It's not like back in the days.
Yeah, exactly. It's,
then our parents would say the same about us. You know, like back in the days.
Eu pessoalmente faço questão. Eu faço questão de ler 10 a 15 páginas por dia. That's what I do. Eu todos os meses I read a book. Que é isso, não é nada especial. Há pessoas que leem muito mais, há pessoas que leem muito menos.
Yeah.
E também acho que tem a ver também com o meio onde tu estás. Que porque, por exemplo, um dos livros que foi o Age que me emprestou, tem o Sabaka, que também é outro membro aqui do podcast que está na beira. Shout out, B-City.
B-City.
e ele também é alguém que partilhamos muitos livros e muitas opiniões e sugestões acerca dessas coisas todas. Portanto, acho que é isso. É como tu disseste também. Nas famílias tem que haver isso. Para poderem passar, né? To go down. Yeah. Mas isso também cabe-nos a nós, né? Agora. So if you want to revive that, we can do it.
I saw a guard, a BCI guard, reading a book once. And I found it so amazing. I wanted to take a photo of him. But then I was like, you'd be like, bitch. You know, because then I thought that was such a beautiful.
But maybe it needs. Maybe you're talking about your friend Maru, and maybe it needs like that sort of. Maybe it's about bringing that awareness, in a way through photography. Different people reading across the city, but like candid, so it's not them posing, but it's like I don't know. But
and that's exactly what I was thinking.
No episódio da Liana, nós também comentamos. Já não precisas ter o livro fisicamente. Now you have audiobooks.
Yeah.
Então, é outra maneira das pessoas irem buscar informação. Yeah. You don't need to read them. You can listen
it's
to them.
It's crazy though, like audiobooks. I don't know. There's something about that the reason I missed reading a book, I mean, guys, the best place I read books is my iPad because I love the fact that you don't have to put a page.
Oh, marker.
A marker. iPad does it for you. No matter where you are, you can read it.
If it works for you, great.
Guys, I wake up in the middle of the night. I just open my iPad and I start reading. You know, with a book, it's a little bit tricky, you know? Yeah, but... you gotta do a little bit of homework. I actually asked a friend of mine right now. I was like, I got this physical book, but I'm finding it very hard to find time to read it, you know? So can you show me where I can get this, you know, online? Because, oh, man, times are hard now. Times are hard. But yes, you are right. We don't only have to read books physically, you know. Nowadays, there's endless ways. But there's something about reading a book. It's your own voice and your own imagination.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I feel like when you hear an audiobook, just like, but that ain't my voice, though.
Yeah. I know
the story
mean.
Just doesn't... I mean, I kill... Just, you know, it's just not the same, you know. Yeah, I don't know how to get into that.
It hasn't got that,
that sauce.
Yeah, I know.
Agora, esta ideia que tu estavas a dar agora é de tirar fotografias das pessoas, podia ser um fun project.
It's just a thought.
Tu desististe completamente da fotografia?
No, and that's what I was talking about. Next week.
Project,
this
week.
Next week.
Plug it.
It's
plug origin. Next week.
The beautiful photos of Regina. I can't wait for everyone to see what we've been up to. She's also an amazing person who pushes people to their creative, to
Regina's
open.
Awesome.
Yeah, Regina is all around awesome. She's not only a friend but a sister to me. You know, and Probably my favorite. I think I design a lot of things for her and thinking about her because of what she represents as a woman, as a Mozambican, as an artist, but also like in her heart, you know, kind of her soul. Yeah, so it's always a pleasure when we get to work together. So I can't wait. I can't wait for you guys to see.
Mas tu fazes tu... o design e a moda é como estavas a dizer há bocado, é para pay bills. Fotografia, então, é something que tu não envolves nenhum sort of revenue.
No, I do, but you know, the nice thing about doing photography and not doing it all the time. So most of the times when I do photos, it's actually bills, right? Like I'm paying bills with it in terms of clients hire me. But I don't advertise myself. It's kind of like people that know that I'm a photographer and want my work will come to me. So like that, I get to keep it as that thing, you know, that it's fun. It's still fun even if I'm making money off it because I don't do it often. That's the reason I also stopped doing wedding photography.
Falar disso mesmo. Por exemplo, eu quando penso em fotógrafos em Moçambique, isso é a minha visão extremamente limitada acerca disso, porque não sou do ramo e conheço muito pouca gente que é fotógrafo. Eu quando penso em fotografia e fotógrafos em Moçambique, eu penso, first thing I think about é weddings.
Yeah.
Casamentos.
Really, dude?
Yeah. Não, mas é. Porque acho que é the main
that's
source
the
of
main
revenue.
One.
Dos fotógrafos.
Oh, yeah.
Então posso,
yeah,
posso estar errado, não é?
Mas no, you're right.
Yeah. You are totally right.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, weddings in our culture.
Sim,
yeah.
São três dias. Hey. Três dias de fotografia.
Yeah. Not only, but like, you know, even during this Rona times, it's the weddings are still happening, my boy.
Depois penso
happening
também
more.
Nos...
Oh.
Ah, é?
Because it's cheaper.
Yeah. Olha, eu por acaso...
Oh.
Yes.
And because
por acaso sugeriram-me, disseram, Márcio, tu, agora é a altura ideal para tu
yes,
casares.
And because
porque
we
agora
also,
tu não tens de convidar ninguém.
But also, remember, we might die, right? So let's put yeah. it all, love.
No one should die alone this
porque
Christmas.
Acho que agora, nah. Não sei agora, né? Porque o Pierre falou ontem, mas... agora são 10 pessoas no máximo, incluindo os noivos.
Yeah.
So it's like, são dois, são os noivos já, e o resto são 8 pessoas.
So you can't really have padrinhos, you have to like...
Yeah, maybe, you have to manage
that. You have to manage the padrinhos,
you know?
You have
the padrinhos, like, yeah, so like you can have like a...
Padrinhos.
Yeah. That,
tava,
like
tava
one
ver,
set.
Tava a ver a,
one set.
Viste-me olhar para o telefone, Ed, estava a ver a data, hoje é dia 6, quer dizer que próxima semana, quando sair o episódio e sair o projeto,
yeah.
De, Iria vai ser dia...
we're bringing 13. It out on Monday.
Ok, yeah. So, então é mais ou menos por aí. Yeah. Só para as pessoas não ouvirem, tipo, ah, ok, para a semana. E depois yeah. ficam à espera da semana.
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
Good yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was just thinking that about that fact. I didn't think that it would be cheaper to actually get married now.
Oh, hell to the yeah.
Wow, but...
No more 300 guests.
Não podes convidar ninguém. Quantas pessoas tinham no teu casamento?
Hey, dude, I don't know. The people I met for the first time on my wedding.
Yeah.
Yeah. How many people were for you? Yes, exactly.
Oh, I had more than Joanna. Yeah, I had, of course.
No, 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 not for like for you. We mean for y'all, like you oh. and your compared to for your parents.
Oh, okay. Like for us, probably I'd say
30.
No, probably around like probably 50
yeah.
something.
Yeah.
Like yeah, and then it's like okay, family doesn't count. Then you have like family. I meant like 50 as in like. Friends and
you know,
and their significant others. So 25,
yeah,
because it's 25 plus one, right? Plus the
ones.
Podes
convidar todos plus ones?
No.
No, but we invited
the
people
ones
that
have
couples,
plus
you know?
Ones.
Não, mas tu é obrigatório?
Not by law, but morally.
Not by law, but it's like
dude, imagine you have a girlfriend and then
it's like,
yeah,
all right,
weird.
Baby, I'm going to this wedding. Okay, honey.
Epa,
yeah.
eu quando
I'll
fiz,
see you later.
eu quando fiz 30 anos e convidei buddies para to go out of Maputo.
Yeah.
Eu disse, são só vocês.
But that's different.
That's
dude.
Different.
Like, casamento is
it's
about
your
love.
Wedding.
It's about matrimony. It's about spending
partnership.
The rest of your lives
yeah.
together. You know, you want to watch
couples.
With someone special. You know, you don't want to watch it by yourself or with a homie. Like, what is that? You know? You want to watch it with the person you love.
get inspired.
Or even if it's the person you love for that second. Exactly. You know what I mean?
Sim, essa, estás a ver? Nobody outra
should,
coisa.
Então, should go through a wedding alone.
Vá lá ver as tuas fotografias dos casamentos e vai ver os teus buddies, desde 50, os teus bradas, que foram com aqueles plus ones. How many of them still with those plus ones? O ratio é grande ou é pequenino?
Why are you killing this wedding game,
no, no,
man?
No. actually, a lot of them are actually still together. Actually, yeah, it's true. I think probably only one or two that are not, but a lot of them still are.
But you're right, though. Like, in terms of in the broader aspect, maybe not you. I mean, kudos.
I don't know.
But
don't
in the broader...
I've been to weddings...
Especially quando são chiguianos.
Yeah, I've been to weddings in SA. And, you know, that's no offense to my South African friends, but the Mozambican weddings are out of control in a good way. Like, yeah. Like, you know, you...
Like
I get excited to go to weddings here.
Yeah.
You know, like that excited.
It's like going
that
to the Grammys.
Yeah, it's like you didn't sleep well the previous night because you're so excited.
Yeah, and you gotta get a new outfit.
Yeah. New shoes. Like, you feel like you're the groom.
Yeah.
You know? like for real.
Eu não gramo nada do weddings. Sério, eu não gramo nada do weddings.
And it's not about just going to eat there. Now it's just, you know, but again, I must say it actually depends on the wedding as well.
Yeah.
Like, because, you know,
if it's your homies.
Yeah, like that's it. If it's your homies or, you know, getting married or things like that, then it's like a different feeling because you're also happy for them and like, and if you know the couple and all of that, right? But if it's like, you know, my dad traveling and my mom takes me as the plus one sort of thing. And
I then hate it's those like, ones.
And then it's like, yeah.
And then they're like, oh, wow, Hugo, como estás grande. Eu vi-te como bebê, mudei tuas fraldas.
Yeah. E tu estás ali com whisky.
Yeah.
And then it's like you're in the grown-ups table and then you're like, oh, I wish I was in that jovens table.
Table.
And then
right
you like
there.
Feel time passing by and you wish you were in that table. They crack the joke and you're like, did I hear that joke? Am I laughing too? No. In the older people's table. Nah, it's cool, man. Weddings are awesome.
Yeah, então eu estava a dizer, a fotografia para mim sempre foi acerca de weddings, é que eu vejo os fotógrafos. Eu não vejo fotógrafos de outras cenas. Não existe, minto. Há poucas exposições de fotografia cá, que eu saiba, mas eu também.
Não há poucas exposições, há poucas exposições que funcionam e têm rendimento. É por isso que não vês. Uh-huh. When I came here, one of my skills, eu trabalhava numa... I worked for an architecture firm, right? For many years. I decided I didn't want to just sit in front of a computer and not talk to anyone because especially when you're a junior, you get given the work and then you just sit in front of a computer.
And you're not allowed
or
to
then
talk.
You, yeah, or then you go to sites, etc. But... You don't interact a lot with people, right? So I got tired of that and I didn't know if this is what I wanted my life to be. But one thing that I had was my photography skills. So I started taking photos for the company, the last company I worked in, the last two companies. Started taking photos and actually building a portfolio. So when I left, my boss said to me, how's about you? Yeah, you can leave, but you continue doing architectural photography. And then I was like, yeah, damn, that actually pays a lot. It pays more than being a junior architect, like four times more, guys. Like, it's crazy. So I thought, okay, I love this. I love photography. I get to go see houses. I get to tell the owners, please leave your house. It's me here alone and maybe with an assistant. And I get to photograph beautiful spaces, restaurants, etc. Sometimes you even at restaurants, you get free food, etc. You know, it's really nice.
Do you do food photography at all? Or
No. I've actually never tried food photography. Ish, I like to eat it, but don't know if I want to photograph it. I tried it once when I was at school, and I didn't particularly like, I didn't think I was good at it. So I was like, But now with architecture, because I can see the lines and the light, etc., like I'm really good at that, I'll send you some photos.
We'll put them up for people to check out. You must plug your photos.
When I came here, I thought, okay, I might continue with my architecture photography, especially because Mozambique is a new place, etc. Guys, zilch, niente. Now there's more going on in terms of architecture photography. But back then when I came back, I think, when did I come back? Like 6-7 years ago, there was nothing. So I had to improvise, see what the market was. I didn't want to do weddings. So I started doing portraiture because people love themselves and people want portraits of themselves, you know. And I thought, okay, this is a market which Mozambicans will love. And that what used to be, what used to pay the bills when I was doing photography full-time. The year I did photography full-time.
Tu já fizeste alguma exposição of your work?
Yeah, so that was 90s. And then the next...
90s foram, era fotografia?
It was multimedia. So it's photography and a documentary and there were t-shirts and there were posts. It was, it's amazing.
The whole shebang.
Yeah, it was multimedia. I worked with quite a few people. And then I did another one at Franco, which is called Les Visages de la Francophonie, which is the faces of Francophone in Mozambique. So that was, I did 90s in November, and then in March the next year I did, yeah. So I'll show you the links to that
and,
also.
And just on exhibitions, like, how was your experience like with that? Like, in terms of like the support, were there any like brands involved or was it all you and friends and favors? And, you know, like for a youngster that's starting out and wanting to know like, okay, I'm a photographer. I don't know how to get my stuff in exhibitions. My friend's saying I should do an exhibition, but what do I do? You know?
Guys, I was really lucky. I had a curator, Frederique Martin. She's also a very good friend of mine, French. She taught me a lot and pushed me beyond my knowledge. I don't know if I would have done that exhibition on my own because I tried to get funding from a lot of places, banks, etc., and no one was funding me. They were like, we've closed our financial year in terms of for artists, etc. You're too late because I planned that exhibition a month before. So in September, and I had to have the exhibition in November, right? So they're like, you're too late. We need like 3 months. Nah, come back next year, right?
I know how the brands
yeah.
feel.
Yeah. So yeah. Fred was super smart. What she did is she contacted everyone and anyone, right? And pre-sold the photos. So we had a private exhibition, but the exhibition before the exhibition.
Yeah.
So by the time you saw the exhibition, 80% of the photos were sold already.
I remember, yeah.
Yeah. So that's how we actually made money to do the exhibition, or else it would have never happened.
And I mean that and to do that, that required you guys to digitally like advertise
yeah.
to people online.
Yes.
And that was another element
yeah.
that is especially in this day and age, is it works, right?
Yeah.
And how was that for you guys in that time?
So it was brilliant because people want exclusivity and people want to feel like something is private and only for them. And that's the system that we used. What was funny, though, is I think only two Mozambicans bought things. The rest were all foreigners. All foreigners from all different countries, but Mozambicans would say, "Oh yes, great idea."
Was it foreigners that living in Mozambique?
Yeah, yeah,
mostly
living
yeah.
in Mozambique. Okay. All of them were living in Mozambique because the exhibition had to be here, and I needed metikaish. I needed
that
cheng cheng. So we only advertised to people living in Mozambique. We needed that payment, that check, and Fred. And Fred went after those people. We really went after those and. She's a go-getter. So she's the type of person like, hey, remember you said yes. Okay, I'm here. Yeah,
but you need that.
Give me
but
that
you
money.
Need that. But you need that. You yeah, need that yeah. type of person in your yeah. team. That's
and you need that as an artist because you are the artist. Like, I had so much to think about. You need that person to just have your back, guys. It is so important.
But that's what the example that I was telling you about you know, people that are good in certain things, you know. And I have friends that are... amazing at doing that. Exactly like, actually, you know, the wrong term is like harassing people, but like they're good at like following up with people in a nice way and going,
yeah.
and you have other people, other friends and people that you know that are not good at that, but they're good at being in the computer and creating the design.
Yeah.
And I think like all these different skills and the point I was making earlier is that like, I think it's more and more, I think even us and our society here in Moz, there'll be more of these collaborations happening and people starting to create these projects and these companies together that are of different skills but have a common goal, you know?
Yeah.
If I look at certain, we had Nunu Suarez, who was here, was a guest on this mm-hmm. platform. And even the ideas that he's coming up with his team and bringing in his team, different people that are good at different things, you know, more and more that needs to happen here in Moz, because yeah. like you were saying, she was, you know, getting behind and like reaching people in order to get the orders done. You need that. And you need to think about being creative and being, you know, because you can't think about those two things at the same time. It's impossible.
No.
Mas ela é alguém que faz isso? Is she a curator? No. Ou é alguém que é só extremamente boa a fazer isso?
She was just really good at it.
Yeah. Por que faço a pergunta? Porque yeah. alguém, se alguém tiver ouvido, se alguém quiser entrar em contato, se alguém tiver alguma
well,
ideia...
Well, she's not here anymore. She's in. She's gone back to France. So, which is pretty.
But hopefully, there's someone that can gain some inspiration out of this.
Yeah,
and actually,
yeah. It's, yeah. It was pretty yeah. sad to see her go, because yeah. after we did the two works together and the French, the Francophonie one at Franco, we did that together, and then she did a few other works with Mudungazi, etc. His exhibition at Fundação late. It was incredible. She worked with him and she kept getting better and better and better and better at doing what she was doing. And I just thought, man, we're losing someone that is so good. But what she did that was brilliant is she left us with knowledge. So everything she did and all the contacts, I have them. I can do it for someone else if someone else needs me to be. I cannot be the artist then.
Yeah, yeah.
They need to shine. I need to be the behind the scenes helping them. Yeah. So when I went to New York to do my my film studies, I did that whole Empower Us movement, etc., alone. And I didn't want Fred's help on purpose, because I wanted to see that I could actually do it. Like I could be that, how do you call it? Is it an organizer, administrator?
What, curator? No. Not really.
Well, because I was a fundraiser. So
yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
I guess organizer.
Yeah. Organizer.
I don't know.
I don't know what the exact term is, but I get what role you're talking about, though.
Yeah. 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 That person behind the scene that makes things happen and creates relationships with people and gets things done, you know? So I it was a skill that I really wanted to learn, because I hoped that in future I could do it for someone else, because someone did that for me. I would love to be able to do that for someone else, you know, and pass it on. Yeah.
Yeah, because that's one of the things here that is so important, that I feel like is from different aspects, especially in the sort of like creative industry, is the fact that we're able to bring in professionals, and even if they work here for however long they work here, but they're able to pass it on to locals.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the most important thing, is knowledge.
Yeah.
And passing it on to locals so that locals can, you know, do whatever they need to do with that knowledge. You know,
yeah.
whether if it's going and creating a business and helping others, or, you know, creating workshops or whatever it is in different provincias in Mozambique.
It's like showing, so yeah. people are self-sustained, which yeah. is, I think, we my mother works for NGOs. So I always say to her, the thing about NGOs and what I see you guys doing is I see you go and build, but people become dependent on you. So when you leave, everything comes crashing down. You don't actually train people to be self-sustained. Like you create a system, you educate it, but then it doesn't run without NGOs, you know what I mean? And I saw that a lot in Palma, etc., where schools were built, guys. The NGO goes, not that school's not even functioning, the teacher's given up, doesn't want to teach, there's no windows, there's no doors, there's nothing.
Toilets don't work, you know? No water.
So that's what we need to start doing, like making people, creating people that, or communities, etc., that are self-sustained and actually fight for themselves and look out for themselves. Before also that they can look out for others, but it has to be a you work at first. Yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
Mm.
It's something that I see that we it's going to, you know, Nelson Mandela, to quote Nelson Mandela, long walk to freedom. No, but jokes aside, I think that there's a lot of issues we have, you know, within our society and different, I always talk about the different roles that exist in different industries, but it really comes down to knowledge. And even a lot of people that I've spoken to in South Africa, and even I try as much as possible, even in my day job, to link a lot of people in South Africa with a lot of people in Mozambique, because it's close, because we're close by, we're neighbors. It's none of this of like a 11-hour flight or anything like that coming from proper overseas, you know, in first world countries to come here and so forth. But even South Africa and Mozambique, there's so much that we can learn from each other. There's so much that even South Africans, you know, in my line of work, that people that learn from Mozambique, you know, it's funny, you try to, a lot of South Africans, although they're either going to mention, yeah, I've been there on holiday, or Tipu Tinto, or Montadoro, or, you know, whatever, the usual. But people that actually work and here actually say that, you know, the Mozambicans are so, you know, they're so humble. You guys are always smiling. You know, you guys are always like happy and upbeat about things, yeah. You know, all of these sort of like characteristics that, you know, that they pick up. Right. But I think that also from our side, learning from there, I think one of the things I admire so much about South Africa, and you mentioned at the beginning of this conversation, was the fact that it's normal to be an entrepreneur.
It works.
It's like it is.
It works.
And it works, and it's easy to not sign up. It's easy to register. It's easy to get yourself going. Like in 1 week, you can have
it
like everything. You're going. You're in business.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that here is still going to, we need to change that here. Somehow, some way, if anyone is out there and has the powers to have some sort of influence.
I'm just waiting for online banking to come through in Mozambique, you know?
Proper.
And I'm not talking about people will say, yeah, BIM does it. How much are we paying? Is it secure to actually do it? And why do we have to go to BIM to do it, you know? And I'm like, maybe Rona times, this
well,
is
what,
it, you know?
What do you mean by online banking?
Well, you know, you've got gateways. You've got to go through gateways. If you've created a website, so you've got your website, and then behind your website, you have gateways. And
yeah.
Those gateways are where the money transacts.
Yes, yes. Like,
and those gateways allow you...
All that.
Well, yeah, Shopify is not a gateway. It's a platform, yeah. But they have their own gateways, but you
yes.
can also... It's PayFast in South Africa,
yeah.
Stuff like that.
Yeah.
So those gateways, we... in Mozambique don't have those gateways, but a bank can actually have a way to link you to those gateways. But why should I have to struggle or pay way too much money for something that the rest of the world has so easily?
I did not
you
know?
Know
about that.
Yeah, not only that, but let's talk about also postage. I mean, these are the difficulties I'm going through and with researching, etc. I've had to, I mean, luckily I'm also...
So sorry, just to retract.
Yeah.
Those gateways you're talking about, for example, is about online shopping.
Yeah.
Right? So
yeah.
For example, if you have your website and you want to create a shop where there's a cart and everything,
yes.
I click, I want to
yeah.
buy this, and then, you know, credit card information and all
yeah.
of that.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's a fee that the bank's going to take
yeah.
from you, the merchant.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about that.
So not only does the bank take it, but the gateways also take it. So they
yeah.
they are the interlink. It's almost
yes.
like they are the, what's it called?
The most famous one.
Banco Nacional or whatever. Like it's where money is like passes through to see that everything is legal,
like,
et cetera.
Yeah,
I don't know how to explain
it
properly.
Reserve Bank? Or
yeah,
the,
Reserve Bank or whatever.
What's the one we have here?
Okay, Banco Mozambique.
Yeah, Bank Mozambique.
Yes.
It's, yeah.
It's like nigga. It's like it's right there. It was like there, but then it's like.
That's what I was trying to say too. And I never managed to say it, you know?
So is the gateway like an independent company, or does like, for example, in
yeah,
this case.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They are independent companies. Okay. Yeah.
So, but like then I said, Beam though? I'm just trying to understand. Like,
well,
why,
Beam, yeah, apparently they're the only ones who do it. They're the only banks that do it. Because
Who have a license, or they actually.
I don't know the 100% process because when I investigated and I was just like, this is too much and too hard. I'm not going to go through this. Because you can do online in terms of, okay, people pay M-Pesa or whatever. But I'm talking about me. My clients are international. How do they pay for stuff with a credit card to a Mozambican online shop?
Got you.
There is no Mozambican online shop like that unless you build it outside of Mozambique. So the people I know who have shops have all built it outside in Europe, in South Africa, etc. Which is what I also had to do. I had to build my site, which I'm reworking.
That's interesting.
In SA, you know? But then also there's the problem with postage. Like, how are we securing the posting? I've been suffering with posting for so long, guys. When I send something to Europe, they'll say, yeah, in 3 weeks it'll be there. It's like 8 weeks, you know? And then it says...
DHL.
Yeah, but the thing is, DHL only gives you exactly.
Exactly. Paper, ching, money, ching, money. Ching, ching.
So yes, there are people that will accept to pay postage for DHL because DHL is much faster, but it's super expensive. It's super expensive.
From the original.
And we're not used to, and the problem is in Africa, we're used to like getting stuff from overseas and actually paying those bills. But taking it out and actually people paying for stuff over there.
Yeah, someone
it's also a different exercise.
Yeah, I can understand that. Someone in Europe that's used to this entire online shopping and free delivery and things like that. And it's like, what?
Yeah.
It's going to cost me extra what?
Yeah, on the National Postal Service deals that it works.
Yeah. That's why it's also an exercise because now they have to be, you know, Africa's new, taver entre aspas, like all these
which
creative
has its pros
things.
And cons.
It has its pros and cons. So you kind of have to be like, okay, yeah, it is that much to post, but we also pay that much to get stuff from overseas, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's madness because, like, even like in Africa, it's new. Well, what's also great about that new is that you also, it's easy to create new infrastructures. Mm. So like even things like rolling out, one example is like satellite TV and cable TV and all of that, which was much easier to roll out in a lot of countries in you know, I'll say Southern Africa for this conversation, because I don't know how it is in East Africa and North and West. But for example, in the UK, when they had to change from, you know, their entire system from having what they used to have with like terrestrial TV to now going into like the digital, it took them a while. Yeah. And it's almost like even in South Africa, they were more advanced than UK at a certain point in that system. So like being new, especially with the new stuff, like new technologies and that, it's easily adaptable in our context, in our garden, our yard, if you call it that, than it is in a lot of developed countries. Because then they have to go in like the infrastructures and that, yeah, the building and all. Yeah.
O con disso é, como você estava há bocado a comentar, que na África tudo é muito mais fácil, é muito mais fluido.
Yeah.
Aqui não, porque lá tu simplesmente entras num sistema que já está montado, já está tudo, a máquina já está bem oleada. Yeah. You just have to jump on the train and go.
You have the form, está ali o formulário, you just put in your
aqui
thing.
Aqui se tu
then,
vens com uma coisa como tão simples, na nossa cabeça é simples porque usamos... websites estrangeiros para comprar coisas, Amazon, e mandamos vir e pagamos as fortunas, pagamos o DHL, and that's
pagar,
like, oh, okay.
Tem que pagar.
Yeah,
it is what it is, né? Yeah. Mandamos vir as coisas, mas agora tu do lado já de business owners, queres fazer isso, já começas a ver essas dificuldades todas, essas barreiras todas que noutros países é muito mais simples, muito mais fluido.
But also, you know what it is, Africa... It's also what I was telling you about Publico Avo. You know, we've got now we have Netflix, right? In Mozambique, etc. You know? And the reason why we have Netflix, it's like, why do we have Netflix but we still don't have an online banking system? Is because it benefits it's more money. Publico Avo. Everyone has a phone that you can watch Netflix on, whether you're in the rurals or you're in the city. Então, é prioridade daquilo that you're that is going to get the masses to buy. Now, create a system for online banking. Guys, we're having problems with teachers teaching online right now. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
you mentioned it, which então is like...
Até, não seria online banking, seria online shopping. Não é?
Talking about the online shopping, but it's because it all connects. It connects with the banks, it connects with the shopping, everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have we can't even like do online schooling right now in Mozambique.
Yeah.
So now imagine it's because we have to think about it like this. There needs to be more people who are into it in order for the country to even bother to build that infrastructure. But how? Because not majority of people can afford to online shop here.
That's in conclusion, that's
so
what
it'd
it
be
is.
A loss. It would be a loss for the banks.
it is. And you mentioned that there, you know, one thing you mentioned as well is that, you know, it's about picking your battles, right? Because you said that, you know, here are just our internet speeds, just this, you know, let alone there's people that can't afford to online shop. But also another factor is that, you know, trying to figure out this whole speed.
Que não tem água.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. Epa.
It's the truth. It's the truth. It's complicated. So again, it's like, it's just about picking your battles. But that's a good observation. And I think that it's tough. I can imagine, like, it's it's always figuring out, like, but also like being tough, there's also a certain, like, I find that with a lot of friends of mine that are entrepreneurs, there's also certain loopholes. So that's so with anything, there's like, it's like this yin yang, like this balance thing. Cause like, yes, there's no online shopping or like internet shopping, things like that. But then at the other side, there's not a lot of like rules and laws and
regulations
around that. So you can basically do whatever you want.
This is the land of possibilities, guys. When I tell you Mozambique allows you to be creative, I mean it in every way, even because of you're allowed to do so much, you know, so much. And it actually makes you streetwise. It makes you smart because when I was in SA, everything was by the books, right? By the books.
It's almost like there was the road plan. Yeah, you could find structure. The road plan and you could follow it.
Here, you gotta go through like bumps and humps and dumps, you know what I mean? To get things done. It makes you really clever and it also makes you even more creative because you've got to find a way. So one thing that Mozambicans is creative. Totally. Yeah.
And Iria, where can people communicate with you and find you online? And
so easy. Iria Marina. If you Google Iria Marina, you'll find Iria Marina. You'll find my Instagram, my Facebook. Iria Marina Designs is more of my clothing, but my main page also has that.
Yeah.
You know, I learned one thing before is if you are a business person or an artist, open up your pages. Your pages don't belong to you anymore. And that's your business front, you know? Yeah.
Thank you. You know that gif that is like, what is it? It's from The Office of Steve Carell going like, thank you. Thank you. That's how I feel right now.
Yeah.
Because opening up your own pages.
Open
you know,
up your pages. Open it all
effort,
up.
Registering a .co.mz, you know, putting some effort into it, I think is a good start. Oof, think about the digital.
That's a hard one, though. I've been there, done that twice. And I found that, to be honest, I found that having websites was completely useless.
I have an opinion on that. That is, when people think of websites, they think that it's like this intensive, like, I gotta think about like all
also
the
also because
things
of how we create them here, like here at home.
Yeah, but there's so much now
like
online. Yeah. But there's so much online now. And when I talk about websites, it's like, I know some amazing websites and I'll post them in the description for listeners to check them out.
Yeah.
That are just one pagers. But in that one page,
where you scroll, I find
everything.
And you're
just like, and that's what I need. I need to know where you are, where I can buy your things, and where to contact you.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. And that's what you have on that page. It doesn't have to be like, okay, and then there's a tab that goes into like how you started. And then there's this entire story, your mission and vision. And then like, no, like no one has time for that shit anymore. Like now it's just like, you know, on that one page, you know, just has your information. Because tomorrow Facebook could shut down, Instagram could shut down, Twitter could shut down. Yeah. And then you're fucked.
TikTok can be banned.
Ooh. Shit, I'm going to go home and create a website.
So, I mean, that's my advice to anyone out there. There's so many amazing
I agree
platforms
with you
100%. Now, yeah. that are you know, even for $10, you can, you know, register. I think it's even less than that.
Even
your
for
domain. Even for no dollars, yeah. There's Wix,
I mean,
there's,
yeah,
Squarespace.
You don't
all
have
these
to have
different...
a domain.
Exactly.
You know, as long
you don't
as it's a website
even need
that's
to have
working,
a,
yeah.
100%. And you can, yeah, even be a .com, which is, you know, if the MZ is too confusing or whatever.
It's too pagas disso para ter Netflix. Come on, just pay for that.
Yeah.
Right? And have your business. Looks legit.
Mm. Yeah. And again, these social media platforms could shut down tomorrow. Yeah. You don't have power over it.
Or freeze. Oh my God. Yeah. Yeah.
MySpace.
I lost music on MySpace, dude. I'm serious. Tom, holla at me, man.
We want Hugo's music back, guys.
I remember Tom from MySpace. Yeah. Yeah. Iria, so upcoming projects, you got the one with Regina, you got the one
with... Ooh, okay. So upcoming projects, it's the one with Regina, it's the one with Filipa. It's the one
else?
With... Yeah. Slick Miguel.
Oh, Miguelito.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, he's my cousin. Love of my life. Love him to bits.
Yeah, he's doing well. Yeah. We must get him in, man.
Very supportive.
Yeah. He participated in something that organized last year with Moleskine Foundation.
Oh yeah, yeah, he's amazing. Yeah. There's one with Edward, the model, who's a brilliant. I don't want to call him a model because I think he is a creative god. You know, the way he markets himself, I'm like, why aren't you doing this for other people? But maybe he's gonna get there. So working with them, and one really exciting one. I am doing a collab, but more like it's a bit more private, but for friends of ours that are going to be.
Oh, okay. We can chat offline.
Yeah. So that's also very. No, that's also, you know, when you collab and you do special things for your friends, it's very exciting,
of course, you know,
because your friends believe in you. So that's the biggest gift for me.
Yeah,
it's the one that
it really makes you, you put even more effort into it.
Yeah.
You know,
and then
you
I don't
want to make it special.
Yeah. And then I don't know if you know Apart, the brand, the dopest.
Is it Apart with an E or no?
Apart with an A. I'll show you. Okay. It's a t-shirt brand. He's a graphics designer, Ollie. I think he's in where? Netherlands or something like that.
Okay.
So we're talking about collabing because he's bringing his line here and we want to put that together. Guys, I'm collabing with
You're
the
busy,
whole
man.
Bloody world.
Jeez, international. I'm international. No, international. No, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Just keep doing what you're doing. Like, you know, we following, we on the interweb, we on, you know, we working on Kubhula website, by the way, just
yeah?
for the listeners
okay.
know. Just so the listeners know.
Okay.
Where, yeah, you know, we, and I mean, I can talk about this, right? Like one of the things that we're trying to do as well is like this, I know I had to check, is this behavior change. A lot of people, I've been listening to our podcast and one of the things that they, observations that they make is that our podcasts are too long. And obviously there's certain people that already listen to podcasts and go like, I'm used to listening to podcasts that are long, you know, like, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours and so forth. And one of the things that we want to start doing is almost, giving advice to people that want to start podcasts and want to, you know, because we believe that...
the so-called roadmap.
Yeah. We don't want to hold this knowledge. Like, we want people to know.
I have a question. Number one is, if people are complaining that your podcast or giving you that perspective that your podcasts are too long, why aren't you shortening them?
because we don't have to do what people tell us to do, because this is a podcast and it's not a radio station.
Yeah, and you can choose to listen or not listen.
Eu pessoalmente eu acho que a melhor maneira de conheceres uma pessoa, the same way que eu sentei-me aqui contigo across from you.
Yeah.
Em 5 minutes eu não ouvia saber nada de ti.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I know.
At the end of the day, it's a conversation.
E mesmo depois de uma hora e tal, quase duas.
Yeah. Yeah.
E eu ainda não te conheço.
Yeah.
Então, quanto menos tempo, eu acho que as pessoas estão muito habituadas a isso, é o que eu digo sempre, a compressed, a soundbites, a manchetes de jornais.
Set questions.
E a não ler os artigos. O attention span está muito curto.
It is. It is. It is. Because we're, I mean, one thing in film, example, in film school, the one thing was, if you're going to do a short story, guys, it cannot be more than, okay, 15 minutes max, but try to make it like not more than 10. So 5 to 10 minutes. People's attention spans are super short. Like, so you got to get to the point, you know? And, but the thing is, like, about your podcast, so you know I spent today listening to the whole, like, a lot of episodes, right? The female ones, because we're still about to come to the question as to why.
There's nothing wrong with, you know, plugging the females, you know.
The thing with it is, it's really interesting, but I did feel that they were too long, but not in a bad way in terms of, oh man, it's just in terms of, yo, I gotta go, but I wanna listen to the full thing because there's so much knowledge that, you know, you're gonna bring, but I gotta go.
Yeah, I know what you mean. the thing I find beautiful in that is that you can continue whenever you want.
Yeah.
Like, you don't have to finish this in one go.
I mean, that's what I had to do. I had to pause it, get in the car, pause it, talk to my assistant,
but you've got
pause
control.
It.
You've got control. Like, you know,
e o que tu disseste agora, there's so much knowledge. A ideia, e uma das ideias principais é essa, é bring in people que tem algo a dizer, que pode share. E quem sabe se alguém não vai entrar em contato contigo, alguém que tem alguma ideia, alguém que ouviu a Wassi, a Regina, a Iria, a Filipa, quem quer que seja, que felt inspired e percebeu que, ah, ok, então é assim que eu tenho que fazer. Então esta pessoa é approachable, então esta pessoa eu consigo entrar em contato com ela through
Instagram,
Facebook, eu tenho estas ideias. Ou o website.
Yeah.
Eu tenho estas ideias, então também é uma forma de quem tiver a ouvir, que pode criar their own network, pode começar a conhecer estas pessoas que se eu procurar na net, não vou encontrar de qualquer maneira, eu tenho que saber. E nós somos, de certa maneira, bastante privilegiados para termos acesso a vocês. E não é todo mundo que tem acesso a vocês.
Yeah.
Então, nós, esta plataforma também é para dar aos moçambicanos todos, quem está a ouvir, acesso a pessoas interessantes e que têm algo para dizer e que estejam a fazer coisas boas.
Não só moçambicanos, the entire world, baby.
It's entire world.
International.
Mas that's the main thing. E em 5 minutos não é possível.
Yeah. So the question, why females came later?
Oh, yeah. I don't know if you want to answer that.
Eu ia fazer comentário muito errado. Okay,
then
I think that's how it works normally.
No. But it's funny, but we're now on episode, this one is 29. Yeah. And, you know, even when we're in the early stages, you know, Sabaka, a.k.a. Kuvush, B-City, local. Now
I love how the name has
he's building a hospital, man. You know, he had to choose, it was either podcast or building a hospital, you know.
Build a hospital.
The boy hasn't got his priorities right, but anyways. You know, that time, yeah, it if you listen to the episodes, the prior episodes, it was kind of like a boys club, and with reason, because we always wanted to do a podcast and catch up with friends and just record conversations, reminisce, you know, and all of that. And that's how this actually started.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Debating on different things you watched, different books you've read, you know, book club, audio book club. No, but that's how it started. It started as that, but we started seeing that there's a lot more interesting, you know, facets in which we can break this in. So every once in a while, we'll have an episode with no guest, where it'll just be us talking about particular things, and then we bring in guests. And I think what's great about the guests is that we're learning too, because
that's why, even though
we might know some of the guests,
we
actually ending up educating ourselves on what people are doing, and at the same time recording that so that someone else can also get closer to that person. And that's why the episodes are quite long. Mm-hmm. You know, if we were to interview you in, you know, something that will cut down to 5 minutes, you know, I'm sure you've done many of those interviews and they're probably online and all of that. And you can go and find them there. While here, like, what's great is that someone will actually go, like Marcio was saying, I didn't know that Iria was like that cool. Like, she's like amazing. Let me approach her, you know, like,
yeah,
let me suggest something to her, or let me, you know, it breaks that barrier, I feel. And the other thing is, most important one, is that we have fun with it. So I think if you're having fun in anything, you know, keep doing
it. Yeah. Mas, resumindo, só agora é que estamos a ter mais females, porque só agora é que nós estamos prontos para receber as females.
That was like a proper diplomatic answer. Like, you know, a proper, like, that deserves a bulla bulla, man. Like, for sure.
Man, you know, in a way I get it. I think we live in times where us females, and this is not a negative in any way before I get attacked. are very aggressive in terms of standing up for our rights and ourselves, you know, and who we are and being true
which
to
is,
ourselves.
Which is not a bad thing.
Which
at
is
all.
Not a bad thing at all. Like, and we should be,
you
know,
be, yeah.
We should be. But with that, I think there obviously has been, it's weird. It's like, who's ready to receive you, you know, who's ready to actually receive the depthness that you actually have embodied in you. Because a lot of people will look, guys, you know how many comments I get? Like, yeah, you're too strong. Like, yeah, you're too, you've done too much. You know, even in the dating world, it's like, whoa, I can't date her because she's done a lot, or she has a lot, or it's intimidating.
Back to the Wasi episode.
You know? Yeah. And it's super intimidating. And it's like, yo, guys, you know, I've done all of this, but at the end of the day, I'm just a human being. I have emotions. I cry. I want love. I want to hug and kiss and be cared for as much
just
as you
like
do.
Everyone
like
else.
Everyone else,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right when you say, I do agree, like, in terms of being ready, because you also have to study that. Study
we've
the acceptance
also had
of
to study
what
our
women
dynamics.
Are.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You know, like, we, like, he wasn't comfortable on the microphone. Look at him now. He's flourishing.
A cada episódio que passa, vamos melhorando. Nós estamos no episódio
29.
É isso. Quando chegamos ao episódio 39, vamos estar way better. Ou 49, porque...
Or maybe
além,
not.
Yeah, or maybe not. Or maybe getting worse. Mas... The thing é que aqui tu, e força-nos a aprender a falar e melhor que isso é força-nos a aprender a ouvir.
Yeah.
Because you just have to sit down and listen.
Yeah.
E essa é a parte que temos estado, e eu acho que sim. Temos
guys,
estado,
this is your journal.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, that hopefully people can take some sort of something from it.
Yeah,
you know,
this is your journal.
That can really take something from it.
Yeah.
But yeah, to end off on a great note and what you're saying about females, like, we, you know, our favorite episodes have been the female versions. No, you know, no offense to the other guests, male guests that we've had in Kubhula. No offense if you're listening. But the female ones are our favorite ones. And you know, we also feel that more and more we want to get more female voices on this platform.
Yeah.
Because I feel that it's really important too. You know, not only us, but also to the listeners as well, to open that up. And again, it's about the length of these episodes is because we can spend time and actually, you know, it's like breaking a lot of the ice, breaking the barriers.
Yeah.
And we can talk about whatever it is that we want. You know, the technology provides that for us. That's why podcasts are amazing. You can talk about whatever you want, whatever topics you want. And the listener also has that control. Similar to you watching Netflix, you can stop, continue later. You don't have to finish in one go, and you can really, really take your time at your own pace.
Yeah, most definitely. And I mean, I gotta say thank you for inviting me. It's been really good to also look back at things. But also to bring positiveness, because like I said, for me, Corona times has been amazing. Like, financially, emotionally, obviously, guys, I need to travel. But but on the traveling thing that you said, yes, we can travel around Mars. I've been doing some. It's not the same, but yes.
I know, yeah, I know.
Especially when you go to like Ashkatas and there's bottles everywhere, etc. But yeah, it allows us to look at what we've actually been doing and see, because man, there's, and that's the thing, like listening to other podcasts, right? Other episodes. That's the one thing I kept thinking to myself. I cannot complain. Like Corona's been really, really good to me and the ones around me. As much as I can be depressed sometimes, etc., but I'm grateful to be alive and to be doing what I want to do, not what I have to do.
Amazing. You
know? Yeah.
Amazing. Iria Marina, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Kanimambu.
Thank you.
And we out.
Are we out?
Thank you.